Father, we thank you now that you have been lifting up your gracious heart. God, we come with expectations and expecting to hear your word from the word of God that will change us, the word that will move us, the word that will cause us to lead in a different manner than you, the word that will chastise us, the word that will encourage us, a living word. We pray now, God, that you open our spiritual eyes and we can see the spiritual realm, our spiritual ears, so we can hear what the Spirit has to say. For we recognize and believe, Father God, that Jesus said, and it is true, that they that worship you must worship you in spirit and in truth. Now God, allow the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart to be acceptable in thy sight. You are our strength and our redeemer. Give us patience as we hear the word. God bless our community, that they will pay attention and that they will stay alert. And we'll give you the honor, the praises, and the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. From this very familiar passage of Scripture, the Scripture that also serves as the backdrop for Sunday morning enlightenment, Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 10. I'm going to read it again because I want us to absorb it. I want us to take it in. This letter says, brother, and I'm going to say sister, if a man or woman is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in spirit of gentleness. Consider yourself as you also be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something, when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own works, and then he will have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. For each one shall bear his own load. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man sows, that he also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing well. For in due season we will reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. I'm going to preach this morning from the question, what's on your canvas?
All right.
What's on your canvas? And I give you the title up front this morning because as I go through my introduction, some of you would have said, maybe you didn't tell us what the title of the sermon is. And so I'm going to tell you up front again. And I want you to do me a favor. I know you don't like to do it, some of you, but look at your neighbor. And since you know I do it a lot, if you don't like the neighbor you sit at, change the seat next Sunday. Say, neighbor. What's on your canvas? My brothers and my sisters, in the Sunday school morning enlightenment lesson, the main focus was directed at the familiar passage of Scripture to which our attention is drawn to the contrast between the lust of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. At our first glance, the writer seems to present this simple dichotomy of good and evil that has fascinated those in the areas of ethics, psychology, philosophy, and religion. In a list that is ageless, the author covers what could be called the ABCs of sin or evil. It is here in verses 19 and 21 that we hear these words, now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revilings, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in the past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Church, it is in this non-exhaustive list that we can visualize the very characteristics of a people without God. I heard the Bible say that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. This morning, if you believe it or not, accept it or not, the ugly truth is that if by chance you're here today and have not identified your current or your past character in this list, every one of us have either been or are currently covered by it, because the writer expands the list to cover us when he concluded the list with the likes. In other words, what I'm saying, if you didn't just get it, is that if you didn't identify yourself in that list of characteristics right now, or before you got saved, you're in it.
All right.
Because he said, anything like these things that you are covered in, they that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, while I can't speak for anyone here today besides myself, the odds are that many of you are like me. You identified your past characteristics in verse number 19. It didn't take us long, or we didn't have to go far, to be able to put a mirror up to ourselves and say, you know what? That used to be me. I want you to hold on to that as they taught in Sunday school this morning, or the Sunday morning of life, whichever one you want to call it. They talked about putting up a mirror. And I don't know if you recognize it or not, but from a past sermon, when you walked in the doors on your left-hand side, there was a mirror. That mirror was covered up with sins that you and I either used to do or we're still struggling with. And so we find ourselves in this characteristics that fall under what the Bible says, that the wages of sin is death. I believe the writer wanted his readers to know that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. He presents the reader with another list, a list that cannot be obtained by man or woman who have been born of the water in their mother's womb. This list is reserved for those who have been born of the Spirit of God. Church, we know this because the author prefaces the list with this description. It says, the fruit of the Spirit. Listen with me to verse number 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. My brothers and my sisters, I would suggest to you today that while you and I may exhibit one or two or more of these before mentioned characteristics at some point in time in our lives, this list cannot become the constant characteristics of our lives unless we have been born again, as Jesus Christ had explained to Nicodemus in the book of John, chapter 3, where he said a man must be born again. Church, when we look at this passage of Scripture from a different viewpoint, we will discover that it is much more than a simple dichotomy of good and evil. It is a forged painting purchased by the master artist and repainted to become an original masterpiece. I'm going to say that one more time, because if you don't know it, I want you to help your neighbor out and say, neighbor, he's talking about you. Y'all don't need to preach, I need you to help. Yeah, so it's your neighbor. And say, neighbor. If you didn't know it or not, he's talking about you.
He's talking about you.
We were a forged painting purchased by the master artist and repainted to become an original masterpiece. Those of you who are art connoisseurs who have studied art, you may be familiar with the fact that the Mona Lisa painted by Michelangelo, it started out as something else, and he ended what he started and he repainted something else, and it is a masterpiece now that is in the Vogue in Paris. Well, let me say that another way, because some of you say, I don't know nothing about art revenue. It is a picture of your and my life, a canvas filled with dark colors and brushstrokes of Satan until we were purchased through the blood of Jesus the Christ, washed white as snow, and then filled with living, vibrant colors and brushstrokes from the Holy Spirit. Let me make that a little bit plainer. What I just said is that our lives was ugly. Our lives was a canvas of dark, eerie gloom until Christ purchased us with his blood. He whitewashed our canvas, and then he painted it with living, vibrant colors. If somebody really comprehended that, that's enough to make you shout. Right now, because you recognize that the old you was good for nothing but to be burnt. But the new you is worthy of hanging in the best of God. As a matter of fact, the gallery that God hangs you in, it is so great that it is the universal gallery, so that all around you and everywhere that you go, they're able to see his masterwork. Maybe y'all don't like that stuff. I got excited when he gave me that revelation. My brothers and my sisters, it is at this point of this new canvas filled with living and vibrant colors that we can make our portion of the pain. I will call the three laws. These three laws are painted with three different brushes. These brushes not only define our canvas, but they also define how we affect the world around us. Join me as we dip the first brush into the paint of verses 1 through 6 of our text, where the writer said, "Brother, if any man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore a one in spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." I want to pause right there for a moment and just say, you know, oftentimes we don't follow this word. We don't follow these directions. And the reason we don't follow it is because oftentimes when we look at others and they are in a fault, we recognize that we are also in a fault, so we don't want to hold each other accountable. But then there are always those that are always looking for fault in somebody, and they'll tell you quickly where you messed up, but they can't see where they messed up. And if I could just help somebody this morning, if we recognize that when we become spiritually strong, those that are spiritually strong recognize what they've gone through, and then they can use gentleness to restore those who are going through the same thing that they have. Verse number 2 says, "Bear one another's burdens." In other words, we need to help each other out and fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. I heard the Bible declare that all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. In other words, no matter how high we think we are, our own righteousness is only good to be burned up. Some of you know what that filthy rag means. I'm not going to talk about that today. If you don't know, see me after church. But let each one of us examine his own work, and then he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For each one shall bear his own load. Okay, I'm going to say that again. Each one of us need to bear our own load according to the scripture. Not very much, but that's what the scripture says. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things, and with him who teaches. My brothers and my sisters, let us call this brush the law of sharing and caring. In verse number 2b, this is defined as the law of Christ. In these verses, we can experience the broad strokes of empathy painted with colors of experience. I can hear Jesus say to the crowd concerning the woman caught in adultery, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." I'm going to say that one more time. I don't know if y'all like that, but I like it. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. Church, it's easy for us to point out the sins of others because it seemingly points to the spotlight from us onto them. I think I'm going to say that one more time. It's easy for us to put the spotlight on somebody else and see their sins and their faults because it seemingly takes the spotlight off of us. Right. But it only takes the spotlight off of us because everybody else is still looking at us. I can remember my grandmother used to say, "Boy, the pot can't call the kettle black." For you millennials, you might not understand that, but in the old days, the pot and the kettle and all the cooking utensils, even the one you bathed in, they were all black and got put on the stove. And so while the pot might have been bigger than the kettle, they was all still black. In other words, if you black, you can't call somebody else. If you ain't sin, you can't call somebody else out for their sin. Oftentimes, my brothers and sisters, we have a big old beam stuck in our own eye while we attempt to remove a speck from our neighbor's eye. The law of sharing and caring calls for the spiritual mature to restore their neighbor in love and in gentleness. Church, I would submit to you that while these brushstrokes are wide and textured, we often fail to use them because they remind us of our own dark past. Yet when we have been truly delivered and walk in victory, we can obey the law of sharing and caring because while we know the feelings of despair, we know what the road to victory looks like. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. We can sing with our brothers and our sisters that old church anthem, "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see." I submit to you, when we understand that we were lost with our brothers and sisters in a fault, instead of us criticizing them and going to them in anger or trying to point a finger at them, we realize that we both were in the same boat. And if it wasn't for the grace of God, we ask ourselves what's on your canvas. When we look at our brother, we recognize that those same colors, those same brushstrokes were on our canvas once upon a time. And we can thank God for how he washed it away, and we can help them to get to the same place that we are. My brothers and sisters, as we endeavor to answer this question, what's on our canvas, not only do we need to identify the presence or the absence of the paint and broad strokes of the law of sharing and caring, we also need to identify the vivid, detailed colors of the law of receiving and giving. Look with me at verse number 6 of our scripture text. It says, "Let him who has taught the word share in all good things with those who teach." The law is painted with a brush of generosity. For I heard the Bible say in 1 Timothy 5:17-18, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. For the scripture said, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out and the laborer is worthy of his reward. Church, this passage is derived from the principle given in Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse number 4. The working ox is worthy of the grain it eats while it is working.
All right.
Those of you that may work, that may better understand this law from a different perspective. In my father's generation, they used to say, the eagle flies on Friday. For this younger generation, it's simply called a payday. The concept is simple. You work, so you expect to get paid. My brothers and my sisters, while many born-again believers embrace this law when it comes time for their direct deposit or for their paycheck, they reject it when it comes to the preacher, the musicians, and others that serve in the household of faith. I think I can hear pin drop.
Alright.
It is this phenomenon that we can get upset after we've worked if our pay is off.
Alright.
And God forbid if we went and looked at our account, some of us don't even check it, because if we have direct deposit, we know that it's supposed to be there on this date.
Right.
And we start to use our debit card without even checking the balance. We just expect it to be there. But when we come to the church, we don't understand this law of painting with the brush of generosity, of receiving and giving. Now some say, well, real wise, they're giving and receiving. I'm glad you asked me that question. It's receiving and giving, because God gives the word and the manna to the under-shepherd of the house. And as he gives it to the under-shepherd of the house, he gives the talents to the musician. He gives the talents to those who labor in the house. And so as they give, you receive. And as you receive, you're supposed to give something. I know y'all want me to move on to point three now, don't you? I think you got the message. But before I move to point three, I will submit to you that the generous not only pay for a good meal. Some of you go to good restaurants, and when you go to a good restaurant, or whether you just go to Chad's, when you get a good meal, you expect to pay for it.
Right.
And when you've had good service, you give a generous tip. Mm-hmm. Is my tip jar out there? So we understand this process. Well, let's not keep you too long. As we endeavor to ask the question of what is on our cameras, we must identify the presence or the absence of the law of sharing and caring, the law of receiving and giving, and finally the law of sowing and reaping. Now I can hear some of your minds moving, those wheels turning in your head. You're asking yourself, well, Reverend, isn't the law number two and three the same? Well, stick with me for just a few more moments and I'm going to answer that question for you. Look with me at verses number 7 through 10 of our scripture lesson. It says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man soweth, that he shall also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will also reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. King James says, if we faint not. Therefore, as we have opportunity, somebody say opportunity.
Opportunity.
Let us do good to all. Somebody say all.
All.
Now look at somebody else and say, even your enemy.
Even your enemy.
He says, let us do good to all, especially to to those who are the household of faith, which clarifies that we're not only to do it to those who are in the church, we're to do it to those who are out of church. We're not only to do it to those who have made a confession of faith, but to do it to those who still need to make a confession of faith. Not only do it to those that we like and those that we love, but we're supposed to do it to those that we hate and we despise. Church, while the law of receiving and giving is painted with the brushes of generosity, the law of sowing and reaping is painted with the brushes of reciprocity. Many of us are more familiar with this concept from a farmer's perspective. When a farmer plants apple seeds, the farmer does not expect an orchard of sour lemons to grow. Church, I believe that Isaac Newton understood this principle when he wrote his third law of motion that states for every action has an equal and opposite reaction. My brothers and my sisters, according to this law of sowing and reaping, whatever brush and paint we choose to use on others, the same brush and paint will be used on us. If we use the brushes and the paint of the flesh, painting the world with the characteristics previously mentioned in chapter number 5, it is the same brush of paint that we will find that fills our own canvas. You and I cannot be low down and dirty to people and expect that people will be nice and kind to us. If I could highlight this portion of the canvas for just a moment, I'd like to help somebody this afternoon. I discovered that most people that are mean and nasty don't believe that they are because their perception of themselves is colorblind. They have no desire to change the brushes or the colors of the paint that they use on others. If you know it or not, the odds are that there are some of those same mean and nasty people listening to this sermon right now. Yet, they don't even know that I'm talking. They think that they're absolutely okay. They think that I'm talking about somebody else. Somebody else that they know. My brothers and sisters, if you think that you need to always set people straight, if you think that you always have to throw shade on somebody else, I might be talking about you. On the converse, if we use the brushes and colors of the Spirit, we will reap the harvest of the Spirit. The harvest is full of the fruit mentioned in chapter number 5. I heard the Bible put it in this way in James 1, verse 16 through 18. Do not err, my beloved brother. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begot he us with the word of truth, that we should be kind of first fruits of his creatures. In other words, that we ought to reflect what God has done for us. Another writer said it this way. He says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Isn't it funny how we only want to give a little, but we expect to get back a lot? I think I want to say that one more time. Isn't it strange how in the household of faith that we only want to give a little, but we expect to get back a lot? But we expect to get something anyway. The Bible said, every man according to his purpose in his heart, so let him give not grudgingly or of necessity. For God loves a
cheerful giver.
Oh, so y'all know it. You're just not doing it. Yeah, it says God loves a cheerful giver. Now let me help somebody real quick. I'm on this thing. When we first start to give, for the most of us, we're not cheerful givers.
All right.
Because we recognize that there's something else that we can give for us with what we give, whether it be of our time, of our talent, or of our treasure. Some of you think I'm only talking about money. That's because that's all you think about. But God gives us more. We give time, our talent, and our treasure. But when we are centered on us, and we're the center of our life, and everything, we should be the center of everybody else's life, then we don't want to give much. Because what we give, we look at how we can use it for ourselves. But when you recognize that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the God that dwells on the clouds, and we don't belong to Him, you know what? The sinner, the backslider, the saved, to answer the question, what's on your canvas?
Right.
We must identify the presence or the absence of the law of sharing and giving. We must identify the presence or the absence of the law of receiving and giving. And we must recognize the presence or the absence of the law of sowing and reaping. And as I get ready to close, using my spiritual imagination, I can imagine that those that are familiar with certain artists, such as the artist of this embellished screen print that you see at the front of the church, you would recognize an artist by its vibrant colors. You recognize an artist by his or her brush strokes. You recognize an artist by the style of their painting or their work. But I will submit to you that the telltale sign of the work that validates it is to be recognized not only by eyes or by the texture, but it is recognized by the signature of the artist. You may recognize this work as the artist duet. And some say, maybe I didn't recognize it at all. But that's all right. Now you know it's the artist duet. It's painted by the internationally renowned Armenian American artist, Matiris. The question today is when the world looks at your canvas of life, do they recognize the colors and the textures of sin? And do they see the signature of Satan? Or do they recognize the vibrant living colors painted by the brushstrokes dipped in the fruits of the Spirit? Do they recognize your canvas? Not only by what they see, not only by the texture of your life, but when they take a close examination, and they look for the master artist.
All right.
Name written and signed in his own blood. Do they see the name Jesus the Christ on your canvas? And if they do, you ought to be able to celebrate. Because they recognize you to be a master. For her, the scripture declared that we were wonderfully and fearfully made in his image. And my challenge to you today, no matter what your canvas looks like, you have a choice of whose brushes, whose colors, and whose signature is signed on your canvas of life. As we stand, again I ask all the sinner, the backslider, backslider, and the savior. What on your hand? Some looked at this picture earlier and they said, that's beautiful. When the world looks at you, are they saying that you're beautiful? Or do they see dark, eerie colors that they wouldn't want on their own campus? If you're here today, you don't know the Lord departs and you say,